Hello everyone, welcome to the new video and last session of the VoLTE end-to-end training campaign. In today's video, we are going to continue with the VoLTE related features explanation and VoLTE bot. In today's video, actually, we are going to present or go through three features, which is the first one, semi-resistant scheduling. Then we'll go through the VoLTE bucket bundling. And both of them is addressing the BDCH condition related part. For example, whenever you have a BDCH condition, so these two features can support the network or help to reduce the congestion for the BDCH. And last one would be about the delay-based scheduling. And this is mainly responsible or like can address the voice quality problems in the network. And we'll go through the explanation of these features. So let's move forward and see what we have. So the first feature we're going to start with today is semi-resistant scheduling. I believe you might be aware about this feature. It's a very simple one, which is, again, mainly used to reduce the BDCH congestion, like to have a BDCH capacity enhancement in general, and particularly to use in high load scenarios. So let's first like try to recall what was the normal scheduling in the VoLTE. If you remember, the VoLTE packets is being transmitted every 20 milliseconds. So you will have the BDCH allocation or BDCH grant will be allocated every 20 milliseconds here. And accordingly, you will have your BRBs or resource blocks and the MCS, or the scheduling part, being allocated to the user every 20 milliseconds based on the BDCH allocation and BDCH grant allocation. So you can see, for example, in this particular scenario, we are assuming that this for particular users being moved, so they're having a different trading condition. So the InnoDB is scheduling different location of the resource blocks, for example, here, as you can see here, and also assuming you have a different MCS. So the resources being changed, as you can see here. While in the semi-resistant scheduling, what it will do, in order to save the BDCH, like to improve or reduce the BDCH condition, it will do the BDCH allocation only one time. In the beginning of the call, for example, it will allocate the BDCH, and this is BDCH will have the grant. It will have information about, again, the BDCH resources or BDCH resource blocks and MCS as well, migration scheme. So, but in this case, it will be fixed allocation. For example, it will have a fixed number of resource blocks with fixed location and also a fixed MCS. Let's assume, for example, MCS 15 or 14 or whatever. So the same resources and location for BRBs and MCS would be used all over the call. So this is means that every 20 milliseconds, there will be no need to having allocation for BDCH resources. So this is will save the BDCH and will have a great improvement in the BDCH allocation, as you can see here. While, but the main point here, which is might result in some drawbacks, that the allocation or the scheduling information for the MCS and BRBs will be the same all over the call. And this is, for example, might cause a problems. For example, if you're assuming in the high speed scenarios, whenever the user is moving with high speed and there is a high variation radio condition, so this is might cause a problem, especially if the user moved, for example, from a good radio condition area to a poor radio condition. So this might increase the silent calls or even the drops or packet loss or whatever. For example, also in the scenarios where the user is moving from outdoor scenario to indoor scenario, so this can also cause a problem. So usually, like this is a scenario-based feature, you can just enable in very particular scenarios whenever you have a very high congestion of BDCH, and also for the scenarios where you are not expecting a lot of variation in the radio condition. For example, let's assume you have indoor, have one sites, IBS sites or indoor sites where you know that the area is very well covered. So for example, you can enable the feature for the site. This is just an example. For sure, every network will have a different behavior, but I'm just giving you some ideas about it. And in general, there is some requisite for this feature. For sure, the user supposed to support VoLTE, plus there is the user support the feature itself, which is called semi-resistant scheduling. And in the next slide, I will explain how you can get the information whether the user is supporting the feature or not, and for sure that the ABC or the core network is supposed to support the IMS in general, IMS-based voice services. And here there is from the scheduling information, the normal scheduling here, that initially you will have a ERAT setup PCI1, and then you will have the BDCH allocation. For example, this is BDCH grant or order one, and every 20 milliseconds there will be allocation for BDCH allocation. DCI information, for example, being sent, BDCH order one, order two, order three. While here for the whenever the semi-resistive scheduling, initially there will be a wrap setup KCI1 and the SPS will be configured to this particular user. Then it will be activated through only one BDCH activation during the talk support or during the call in general. Once the user, the call being released, the BDCH or the SPS would be deactivated through again sending a DCI from init B to the UE. So this is in general about the feature. Now let's move to the next part about how to check the capability of this feature. So as you can see here, for example, this is explaining how you can check the capability, SPS capability, whether the user supporting the semi-persistent scheduling or not. For example, if you look into this figure, this is from the UE capability information message. Like whenever in 4G you have UE capability information being sent. So you'll find under the UE capability message, you can just go UE capability information, then you'll find UE track capability, then under RF parameters, you'll find something called FGI or feature group indicators. And this is one of the very important messages to know about it, especially for the UE capability. As you can see, it's like consisting of 32 bits. Each bit of those is like indicating a particular feature, whether this feature is being supported or not. In the next slide, I'll give some information about it, and I will attach the details about each of these bits, the explanation or definition in the video description. So for example, the bit number 29 here, this is showing whether the user is supporting the SPS semi-resistant scheduling feature or not. For example, if this bit is one, this means it's supporting. If zero means it does not support. So this is like simply what to do. The next part here, actually, it's about whenever the user, the init be configured the UE with SPS. This is the configuration of the activation. The configuration would be done through the layer 3, while the activation would be done through the DCI information. So for example, here, this is RR3 configuration message being sent at any time. It will have this SPS configuration downlink confirmation or even uplink. And if you'd like to get more details about this part, you can refer to this below link, it having very good information as well if you would like to go for more details about it. So now let's move to the part related to the FGI feature to give more explanation about it. Okay, this is just like I quoted this table from 3GBP TS36.331. This one, you can see this is like showing the table for all the bits and under the FGI or feature group indicator, which each one of those bits like giving explanation or like addressing whether this bit supporting or related to which feature. For example, if you look into this bit 28, it's just showing to you TTI bundling. For example, if bit 28 is one, this means a user supporting TTI bundling feature. If it's zero, this means it does not support. Same for 29. For semi-persistent scheduling, and same for the handover part. And again, I will attach the video description, the complete explanation for the 32 bits, because here I give some examples in the video description, just for your reference in case if you need it for any other use. So now let's move to the next feature, which we have today. The second feature actually is also one of the very good feature and also easy to understand features. For example, this is called downlink VoLTE packet bundling. And from the name itself, it's kind of giving some explanation about this, how this feature works. For example, if you look into this, the normal scheduling again, which we explained the same in the previous slides, that the allocation will be every 20 milliseconds, and you will have your BDCH resource clocks and MCS and so on. And here you can see every 20 milliseconds, you have BDCH allocation, and you have the related resource clocks for the BDCH and for the MCS as well. So you will have the packets here. While this feature, what to do, as you can see, it's called downlink voice packet bundling feature. And as explained here, this feature can bundle, or two voice packets can be bundled for the scheduling. What it mean by this? For example, you have one voice packet here and one voice packet here. So instead of sending in two different intervals here, as you can see here, it will just bundle both packets together here. So we'll have more allocation for sure for the BDCH, but this will save the BDCH in the next interval. So the next interval, you will not have any VoLTE packets because both of them being transmitted here. And this will be repeated again. So for example, the scheduling here, instead of 20 milliseconds, it will be each 40 milliseconds. So as you can see, this will save also a lot of BDCH, like can improve the BDCH capacity. But at the same time, also it's having a drawbacks or downside because it can increase the VoLTE latency. As you can see here, this is whenever we enable the feature before, we have seen an increase in the VoLTE latency. So this is one of the drawbacks. So again, this is like also scenario based, depend on whatever the target or your target in the network where you need to optimize. So now let's move next to the last feature of today's video. Okay, the last feature here is called delay-based scheduling, and you can say this is like kind of become a must feature where it must be enabled, because this is have a very good impact in the voice quality and also in the sales, particularly for the sales users. Well, it can improve the block error rate, also the voice quality will improve a lot for the sales. So how this feature work actually? Actually, this feature work based on the buffer delay, or you can say that the E2E will look into the users where it's having in its buffer. So if it's found some users where it's having a high waiting time, for example, the buffer delay for these users is very high based on some values. This might be depend on the vendors itself. So for example, assuming here UE1 having a waiting time more than 30 milliseconds, UE2 have 25 milliseconds. So this will be the priority of the scheduling. So the normal case scenario for the scheduling, you know that we have round robin, you have max over I, and you have this kind of things, if you remember for 4G in general. But in this case, we'll use this. This is how the feature will work. It will prioritize the users with high buffer or high waiting time, like instead of the user was having less waiting time. So let's try to simulate this to see how this feature works. Assume this is your scenario. This is the buffer delay of in the E2E side. This is the E2E side. And here we have UE1. UE1, we assume that the waiting time is more than 30 milliseconds. And we have CQI number 7. So assume here you have 3 packets for user 1, 3 packets for user 2, and 3 packets, for example, for user 4. And this user one is edge user. It's having a poor radio condition. It can be in downlink or uplink, but I'm just giving an estimation like that to just present that this user is kind of edge user. So if you can see this buffer delay, the arrow here indicates that the buffer delay is very high. So whenever the packet is up here, this means the packet has been waiting for a long time. So how the scheduling will be done for the users? In this case, the E2E itself will prioritize the packets with very high delay. So for example, the first packet will be transmitted, will be this particular packet. So if you move this one, it will be the first packet to be transmitted to user one. Again, if you look into the second packet, still having a higher waiting time compared to the others. So if you click in here, also this will be scheduled for the users. Now moving for the second user having this packet, which is also having a higher buffer delay compared to the other users and the other packets. So this again will be scheduled. Here moving for UE4, it will be the same. So to be scheduled, then this one, then we'll have this one, then this one will be moving, and so on. This one, then we'll be ending for that one. So in this case, this is what it will do. It will improve the voice quality because you improve the waiting time, this user becoming having a more faster scheduling. And for sure, this is will be reflecting from the KPIs point of view. You can see improvement, for example, in block error rate, especially in the uplink. And this is what we have seen before. And even from if you have the most drive, you can see also the voice quality will be improving a lot. So let me show you an example from one of the networks. For example, here after enabling the delay-based scheduling, you have seen more than 20% in improvement in the uplink iPlayer. And also from the drive test at that time, we have seen improvement in the voice quality. And that's it. That's all for today's video. And this is the end of the end-to-end training campaign. I hope if you like the complete training sessions, I hope you can share it with your friends and colleagues. This is to spread the knowledge and also to get more reachability to the channel. And for sure, there is a lot of things, other things for the VoLTE which can be covered. But this is, I think, whatever we have covered in today's video is kind of very fair enough to get started to the video and even to reach into a very advanced level. So thank you very much and see you next video. And please press like and drop a comment and share the video with your friends. Thank you and see you next video. Bye bye.